The New England country doctor takes on every kind of case and sees the whole range of human emotions, from the joy of a baby girl's birth to the sad struggle of an old man clinging to life. Traveling bumpy back roads and putting in endless hours with a constant stream of patients, it takes a special dedication to practice medicine in the North Country, but most of all, it takes a person who cares deeply for his patients.
Sprayers are hard at it now on Jack Smith's potato farm. In Presque Isle, David Jones works his practice. 30 patients a day, 15-minute bursts of focus, diagnosis, prescription.
Probably 80% of what comes into the office is going to get better anyway, so it doesn't need tending to. And so it's hidden agendas. It's other things that are in people's minds. It's talking about their family, talking about their job, or coping with stress or worries about cancer.
Elsie Blanchard has a problem with her husband.
Do you worry about him?
Well, he worries me.
He worries you?
Mm-hmm.
By keeping you busy, taking care of him? Or?
Well, it isn't I have to take care of him, but it's just that he gets on my nerves so bad. He's a man who likes to have his own way. Mm-hmm. No ifs, ands, or buts.
Do you think that makes your stomach hurt more sometimes when you really get frustrated with him?
It just makes me nervous. It makes me just want to screech.
We've tried her on lots of different stomach pills and anxiety pills since we can't change the home situation, and nothing's really worked. But as she was leaving, she said to me, I just feel so much better now that I've just come and seen you. And so a lot of it is just venting for a minute or two and getting to laugh and having somebody laugh at her.
Family practices like that. A lot of talk medicine, maintenance medicine. The morning goes on, a look at a young man with suspected strep throat, a wart that needs freezing on his mother's hand, a follow-up check on a child's earache. The appointments in Presque Isle continue. By 1 o'clock, Dr. Jones has stopped at the McDonald's on Route 1 and turned down Route 164, heading towards his other office in Washburn and another round of patients. On his way, he prescribes a 30-minute break for himself and tries to find some brook trout.
It's a wonderful break. I just stop by and throw in a worm for a few minutes or cast a fly out. I do feel helpless sometimes practicing medicine. There are times when it doesn't matter what my skills are or what I know about what's going on, I can't change it.
Washburn, Maine, a small town with wide streets. The potato trucks only have to downshift twice before they are through the town. There's the snack bar, Don Rosignol's barbershop, and there is David Jones's office in an old firehouse. The waiting room is filled with the afternoon's work, a repeat of the morning's. The first case is Raymond Baker, age 37, a copper mill worker with chest pains, changes on his EKG, and Dr. Jones suspects heart disease.
This may all turn out to be nothing, and I'd love it to be that. People can have cardiograms that look like yours that are what we call variants of normal. Doesn't mean they have underlying heart disease. But I think I can't say that until I do some tests on you. So, does this all scare you?
A little nervous.
No, not
the cameras, no. But
yeah, I mean...
If I wasn't scared, I wouldn't be here.
Yeah, all right. Because you're young. You know, and a lot of people when they're young get scared but won't go and see the doctor. They deny it.
Raymond Baker is scheduled for stress tests. The Washburn schedule moves on. In the late afternoon, David Jones heads out for his first house call of the day. It is 5 p.m.
Tonight, we are seeing some rare moments on television, the most intimate conversations between doctor and patient. But modern medicine has its limits. A doctor can only do so much. Sometimes the only prescription left is love and care.
the home of Charles Ballard, retired.
What's happening with you? They tell me you're getting weaker.
I don't think I've got any medicine to make you stronger. And I guess if I could write you a prescription, it would be to walk as much as possible. Because I think that's probably the most important thing for you right now, is getting some more exercise. Charles Ballard's an elderly gentleman who essentially has failure to thrive. He has given up the will to live. I've taken care of him for 2 years. I haven't been able to find anything medically wrong with him. I had him in the hospital recently for one medical illness, and that was urinary retention. We did the necessary surgery, and he did well from that, and once again, he's fading.
Midnight on the water, Sunday on the lake, a beaver or an otter.
As the sun begins to cool in the fields, the day winds down. In the fading light of afternoon, there is a melancholy in Maine. The cycles of life seem stronger, more connected. The day hangs heavy in its last moments. The warm metal of forgotten trucks takes on the evening cool. And over the darkening hills at the hospital, the rooms on Medical 2 grow quiet. Evening rounds. David Jones visits Arlene White, age 73. Yesterday, she suffered a profound stroke, which has paralyzed her left side. Her husband, Carl, also had a stroke some time ago. He has esophageal cancer as well. She's been taking care of him up till now.
Do you know where you are today?
Presque Isle
Hospital. Do you know what's happened? You know you had a stroke?
Hey, Dr. Jones.
I'm Dr. Jones. You had a stroke the other day. A shock. And it's left your left side not working, your left arm and your left leg. And you're unable to turn your head to the left or even look over there. That's to the right. You're going to be in the hospital here for a while, okay? I know you worry a lot about your husband.
Yes, I do.
Often, we are the handmaiden to death. I can step back and feel a lot of pain and hurt for both of them. The world's falling apart. She's unable to do the things that she feels are the most important things in her life right now, and that's to care for a dying husband, because she's dying now, too. It's hard. It hurts. When I was a child, my dad told me that you always have to touch a patient. Maybe somewhere inside, I think there's some transfer of caring or energy or concern, or I don't think about it. It just happens.
Good night on the water, sand and cedar air.
Special thanks to Jerry Kirschenbaum, who produced that extraordinary portrait of Dr. Jones. And thanks, of course, to Dr. Jones himself. That is it for tonight's edition of Chronicle. We're back on Monday with a special report, a live half hour with John Kerry and Ray Shammy. Both men want to be senator in a race that looks right now like it's too close to call. They have plenty of differences, from abortion rights to military spending. We'll look at all of that Monday night on Chronicle. And Sunday morning at 11, our 5-on-5 panel looks at, among other things, the Donovan indictments.
All right, we leave you now with some final scenes from our portrait about Dr. Jones. Wish you a good weekend.
Thanks for being with us.
Good night.
All the little people living near the clearing by the pond, they are dancing in the moonlight. They'll be dancing till the dawn, and the moon looks down upon them like a fat and laughing man, and he's the keeper of magic, he's the leader of the band. Now somewhere there's a cottage, and somewhere there's a door, and somewhere there are ponies running wild across the moor. There are lilies of the valley nodding gaily in our way, and our hearts are all on fire.
fire, and the night is ours to take. 'Cause there's a moon upon the left, there's a star upon the right, there's a nightingale to sing to the wondrous summer night. There are gentle deer grazing in the meadow with no fright, and there's no past and there's no future, only now. And we have chance.